Hello everyone, it's Nora, the Lekker Queen here. Wow, 2023 has been an absolutely epic year. A lot of firsts and a lot of new plants. And I want to show you today the plants that I've really enjoyed spending time with in 2023. Some plants are new, others are oldies, but there is something in this tour for everyone. So let's get started. This is one of my favorite, absolutely favorite plants. And I know you're going to get sick and tired of listening to that statement, but it's absolutely true. This is my Hoya Lisa, my Hoya Australis Lisa. She is a gorgeous plant. She's living in a 14 centimeter pot in Lekker. You can see her roots there. This plant is absolutely thriving. Look at that new growth. Look at those little tiny red leaves that have just come out. It is absolutely loving life in these Lekker clay bowls. I put a trellis on this plant and it's held together. It's held by these little clips on this trellis, climbing up this trellis. And I think this plant is really going to be a showstopper once that growth really, really takes off and just completely covers that trellis. But in the meantime, it is growing really well. It was a really tiny plant when I got it. And this is one of the first Hoyas that I just wanted so badly. And I spent so much money buying this plant, which is really stupid because it's really cheap now. But there you go. So that there is my Hoya Australis Lisa. Next up is my Anthurium Crystallinum. This is a gorgeous little plant that I just recently acquired. Look at that leaf. How amazing is that? Look at those distinct veins. This plant is really loving life in the Lekker clay bowls. I'll take it out of that reservoir and show you what those roots are doing. Oh my goodness, the plant is just loving life. These are the roots that are growing into the reservoir. And you can see here, you know, you've got that protruding all the way up there. There's a new leaf coming through there. I clearly need to repot this plant because it's living in, I think this is like 7.5 centimeters, tiny, tiny pot. It was small when I got it and look at it now. Just absolutely loving life, Anthurium Crystallinum. I have had someone say to me that Anthuriums can't grow without soil. They need to have soil in order for them to grow. And I think I probably just said I respectfully declined. That is not true at all. And as you can see, my Anthurium Crystallinum there is growing fabulously without soil, living in Lekker clay bowls, loving life. So it is possible to grow Anthuriums without soil. And part of what I want to show you in this video is not just, you know, showing you the plants that I love, but also to show you the vast array of plants that you actually can grow in Lekker clay bowls. You can pretty much grow anything that you want, I think. With a little bit of care, you can. So part of this journey for me with you guys today is just to show you the various plants that I have growing in Lekker clay bowls. Up next is this gorgeous baby. This is the maidenhair fern. I love this plant to death. It doesn't love me as much as I love it. That is just the honest truth. I've had a plant, a maidenhair fern, in Lekker before that did really well. It got spidermites and died. This is a new plant that I've recently got. I've had it for a few months now. I did a big video about how I transitioned this plant from soil to Lekker. If you haven't seen it, I've got the link up above. But this plant so far, I'm quite happy with the progress that it's got, actually. There's quite a lot of new growth down there, as you can see, these little bits here. There's lots of new growth coming. So I'm really, you know, I'm quietly optimistic that this plant is going to do well, because maidenhair ferns for me we've not had a good history. But as you can see, this plant is living in Lekker clay bowls, so it is possible to grow a maidenhair fern. Now, how do I treat this plant? It's got that reservoir, so I've got the nutrient solution in that reservoir. I am giving it quite a lot of light. It is underneath a grow light, actually. That is just the truth, and it is surrounded by a lot of plants, so it is quite humid. I don't have a humidifier with it at the moment, and I think I can see there's some crispy, you know, little leaves there. But I think all in all, I'm quite happy with the way this plant is progressing. Fingers crossed, it will continue to get bigger. This is another one of my very special babies. This is my Syngonium Fantasy, or my Syngonium Albo. Ha, oh, this plant is absolutely something. She's living in a 14 centimeter pot in lecker clay balls. Look at those leaves. Look at the fantastic varied variegation that she's got going there. She is just spectacular. Look at how awesome this plant is living on that moss pole. That's her moss pole there. And you can see, look at that. Area roots weaving in and out that moss. That plant is really loving life. I've gone through quite a journey with this plant, actually. I've been trying to get her to look this way probably for 2 years now. I think I've had lots of all white leaves scarp on my efforts. I've had leaves just not doing what I wanted them to do. I've had to do lots of chopping, lots of propagating. And finally, I think I have definitely got to where I want to be with this plant. She looks absolutely fantastic. I recently extended her moss pole, so we've still got quite a ways to go with the growing. And the last time I actually put up a reel or a YouTube short about this plant, someone asked me, why aren't those leaves maturing? Syngonium leaves actually start to take on a different shape when they're matured. And I'm like, I don't know. I couldn't tell you. You know, maybe it wants more light that I'm not providing. I don't know. But all I know is I'm just happy with the way this plant looks right now. That is my Syngonium Fantasy. And that is what your Syngonium can end up looking like when you put it on a moss pole, allow it to climb and do its thing. Syngonium Fantasy. This is actually a tree fern fiber pole. It's a pole made completely of tree fern fiber that's living in there. And this is my Epipremnum Shangri-La. I love this plant. Those leaves are so unique. They've got this really interesting shape to them. And I think, I'm not sure if this is the variegated version. Well, it looks a little bit variegated. You can see a little bit of yellow in there. So maybe this one is the variegated plant. Look, to be honest, this plant has not been doing very much for me. It hasn't been growing as fast as I've been told that they can grow. So I was getting a little bit concerned. I mean, to be fair, it didn't have as much light as I think it probably could have done. I've recently changed the lighting situation for this plant. I've got a grow light in front of it. So it's probably why, you know, this new leaf is a lot bigger than the others were and it's opening up a lot more. I don't know. But that is my Epipremnum Shangri-La. But what I want to show you as well with this plant is you can see back there, which I hope you can. Look at that. That's an area root. There's some area roots in this, I almost said moss, in this tree fern fiber. So the plant has actually really anchored into that tree fern fiber. And those area roots are looking so, so healthy, growing all the way down into that lecker. And that's that lecker there. And you can see, I'll put this down for a sec. That is one of the roots of the plant. So there's quite an extensive root system within this pot. So I think now that I've actually got the lighting good for this plant, I think it's really going to thrive. I can't wait for it to get all the way up to the top. I think it's really going to look fantastic. And that is my Epipremnum Shangri-La. This is a tiny plant that packs a lot of punch. This is my Monstera Adansonii variegated. Look at that little albo version of this gorgeous plant. It looks absolutely fantastic. And you've got this half moon effect going on with those leaves. It looks absolutely brilliant. It's so, so gorgeous. I love how tiny it is. I'll show you what the root system looks like. It's, of course, living in lecker. And there's some roots that you can see there. I'm not too sure if you can see that properly with that light shining there, but oh my gosh, this plant is absolutely amazing and way too cute. This plant was a gift, actually. This was given to me by my gorgeous friend Pete of Pete versus Plants. And when this plant was actually transported to me, came in the post, it did not travel well. and it was pretty much a wet stick by the time I got it. So I've nurtured that wet stick, and this is what she now looks like. It is so, so gorgeous. I absolutely love it. And there's a new leaf that's coming up over there. So, you know, I think this is just going to be an absolute showstopper. So the question now is, do I give her a moss pole or do I leave her exactly the way she is? I don't know. What do you think? Let me know in the comments below. Should I put this plant up on a moss pole? Another one of my favorite Hoyas. This is my Hoya latifolia albomarginata. Latifolia albomarginata. What I love about this plant at the moment is this. Look at that leaf. That leaf is almost the size of my hand. And just look at that gorgeous variegation. It is absolutely to die for. There's another one. This one is even bigger than the one I just showed you. That's definitely as big as my hand. How amazing is that? And then look at these teeny tiny new ones that are just coming up. They're still quite red. They're new. Oh my gosh. This plant has absolutely understood the assignment and is just growing and thriving and living in a 10 centimeter pot, tiny, tiny pot in like a clay balls. And you can see those roots just absolutely loving life in those clay balls. That's the roots there. That is my Hoya latifolia albomarginata. This plant hasn't shown any signs of giving me any flowers, not just yet. So I've got my fingers crossed. This plant is living in my Hoya grow tent. I do have a grow tent where I've got most of my Hoyas living. So there is a lot of light in there. Crazy foot candles going on in there. It's very humid because I've got all the plants in there together. One of these fine days, I will take you on a tour of my Hoya grow tent because it is something to behold. There's Hoya vines everywhere. They're all mixing in with each other. And yeah, absolutely loving life. Hoya latifolia albomarginata. Let's look at something a little bit different this time. This is my trailing philodendron Rio. I love the colors on this plant. They are absolutely amazing. Look at this one. This one is almost completely white. Obviously, that's not a very good thing, but you know, what can you do? That's a new leaf over there. This plant is just, it's so cute. It's really, really nice. It's one of the few trailing plants that I have. I just don't have the heart to put this plant up on a moss pole. I think it looks absolutely beautiful exactly the way it is. I am thinking though, you know, the moss pole lover in me is thinking maybe I'll just get off, you know, just a little section of that and put that on a moss pole and see how it goes. It would be really interesting to see these leaves get bigger. What do you think? Do you think I should put part of this plant on a moss pole? I definitely want to keep it trailing for the vast majority of it, but I'm very curious to see what it would do growing up on a moss pole. I would love your feedback. Let me know in the comments below. That is my gorgeous trailing philodendron Rio. This is my Monstera deliciosa. This plant is really, really big now. I hardly ever get to show it because I can't move her to make her film ready, so the light's going to be terrible. And she's pretty heavy now. This, look at that. That's an area root that belongs to that plant. That's another. Look at that. Hey, how is that an area root? That's the newest leaf up there, and it's already got the secondary fenestrations. It is just amazing. I've got three plants on this moss pole, and I'm telling you, this plant is living in lecker clay balls. That is the honest truth. Hang on. Let me see if I can pick that up and show you. That is the pot. There we are. That plant is living in lecker clay balls. All right, good elf. She hasn't fallen down. This plant is living in lecker clay balls. She is growing insane. I actually need to repot this plant because she's living in a 20 centimeter pot right now. which is a little bit small, to be honest. And it's not as steady as I would like it to be. So I'm constantly worried that she's going to topple over. But look, that is, I'm literally standing up right now. I can't show you the whole plant because I can't get her in the frame. But I love her. She's my OG Monstera. No variegations, no nothing. I got this plant as a freebie when I bought a plant from some lady, I don't know how many years ago. So she is loving life. She was one of my very first soil to LECA transitions, and that's her now. This is my Hoya Polynura. Look at that gorgeous baby. I love this plant. I love the shape of those little leaves. Look at how amazing those leaves are. And then you've got those little striations or those lines going through the leaves. And you can see more of that, especially when you turn it around looking at the back. It's just absolutely amazing. It's like you've got a whole bunch of mermaids just living in your pot. It's fantastic. When I got this plant, it was just a teeny tiny plant. It was literally just the one branch. So I've been propagating over the months, and I want to have a really bushy Polynura. I want to have all those like lots of different branches and fronds just falling off this pot. So it's still not very big because every time it grows a little bit long, I chop it and I propagate it and I put it back in that pot. And I've just recently done that. But yeah, that's that plant living in LECA clay bowls. That's its reservoir there. And I think it's doing really, really well. But of course, some of you might know that one of my absolute dreams is to get a variegated Hoya Polynura, because Kevin of Hakuna La Planta has one and it just looks gorgeous, gorgeous, gorgeous. Can you imagine this in a variegated form? So, you know, if there's anybody out there watching this and listening and would like to gift me a variegated Polynura, I would not say no to that. But that is my Hoya Polynura. Mermaid Hoya. Well, I've been talking about love, my love of things. And well, I mean, I just have to talk about my love of this Hoya Carrii, the Valentine's Day Hoya, the love Hoya. Mine has just exploded. Look at that. Look at that vine. And that one. And then look at these gorgeous, just absolutely gorgeous leaves. Look at that tiny one. That's a really, really tiny new one. That's just, I mean, as heart-shaped as you can get it. But what's even more amazing about this plant is, look at that. Look at that. Look at that. It is about to flower for me, ladies and gentlemen. Look at that. There's one, two, I think there's another tiny one there. Three. Oh, there's another one back here. Hang on, I'll turn it around. Oh, I don't want that nutrient solution to spill on me. Right there. That's another one there. And look at that tiny leaf that is just growing there. Oh, there's another one. There's another one there. So there's one, two, there's about six. That's my Hoya Carrii. This plant is really loving life. Also living in the Hoya grow tent. There's a lot to be said for actually providing optimal conditions for your Hoya. So this plant is really just right next to that grow light. It's got that humidity. It is loving it. Hoyas do love quite a fair bit of light, some of them anyway. So yeah, this one definitely does. And when she flowers, you will be hearing all about it. So keep an eye out, especially on my Instagram. That's where it's easier for me to put like to-the-minute updates of what's happening with my plant. It's a bit harder to do videos all the time, but it's easier for me to take pictures and put them up. So if you haven't yet accessed my Instagram, just check out the link in the description below and go ahead and give it a follow. And you can see all these babies almost in real time. Enough Hoyas. Let's talk about allocations. This is my Alocasia Black Velvet, people. Ooh, this is one of the Alocasias that absolutely loves me. You know, I've got a very interesting history with Alocasias. You know, they go dormant on me a lot in winter. But this is one that's just been loving life throughout the seasons. That's her living in her Leka pot. And oh, there's actually a quorum right there. That's a quorum that's forming. That's about to be a new plant. This plant is just happy. You know what I mean? Look at those leaves. They are just beautiful. It is glorious. It is thriving. There's actually three plants in here. One, two, three. And I'm pretty sure that looks like it might be a flower. I don't know. But that is my Alocasia Black Velvet. It's just, you know, doing what alocasias do. And this is why we love alocasias. This is why I can't keep away from alocasias, because they just look absolutely magnificent. So don't listen to that Nora who tells you that you shouldn't buy an alocasia because alocasias will break your heart. Listen to this one who shows you an alocasia that looks like that and makes you fall in love with alocasias all over again. Oh. Alocasia Black Velvet. Kind of keeping in theme of plants that go dormant, let us talk about caladiums. This is my caladium symphony. Oh my gosh, look at that leaf. Is that not beauty personified? Look at how marvelous nature is. I mean, you couldn't make this. No one could come up with this. This is a new leaf coming up there. She is absolutely stunning. Absolutely stunning. That is the pot that she's living in. She is living in Leka. And that's her root system coming out of the pot. And this plant is just, it's really, really happy. This here is a new little plant that's come out of the main plant over there. So that's, I probably could separate that from the mother plant if I wanted, but I won't. I want this plant to be absolutely bushy. And we're now in summer in Melbourne, so this plant is thriving. And when the seasons change, it is going to struggle. I don't want her to go dormant. So in order for me to prevent that, I will keep her in the grow tent. I'll make sure that that grow tent is nice and warm. So I do have a heater in my grow tent for plants that love to be a bit warmer, because I want to see this magnificence all year round. That, ladies and gentlemen, is my caladium symphony. Look at that. Can you imagine that as an earring dangling off my ear? How awesome would that be? Let's go back to a tiny plant. This is my Anthurium Guatemalan cross with a Clarinervium. What I love about this plant, aside from the fact that I actually grew this plant from seed, so I'm really proud of myself, look at those veins. They are just so bright, so sparkly. I don't know if you can actually see that on screen, but it is so, so sparkly. It's just amazing. I love, love, love this plant. There's a new little leaf coming over there. That is going to be an amazing plant. So like I said, I grew this plant from seed. And I think I germinated the seeds in sphagnum moss. And I put, once they germinated, I put the plant in Leka. And it's now living in a very tiny pot. You can see that's the root system there. And that's my Italian Leka in there. That is my Anthurium Guatemalan cross for the Clarinervium. I'm really, really happy with this plant. I can't wait for it to grow. I didn't have too many germinate, so I think I've probably only just got the one. But it's a precious little thing. I'm happy with her. So yeah, Anthuriums definitely can grow in Leka clay bowls. And don't let anybody tell you that they can't, because that's not true. Next up is another philodendron. This is my philodendron Burl Marx. I love this plant. This plant is actually supposed to be variegated. It really is. If you look at that stem over there, you can see that it's got some lovely variegation on that stem, which is not seen so much on the actual plant itself. This used to be a variegated leaf, and that's a variegated leaf as well. The rest of them are not as variegated. And look, I could probably manage it and just probably chop off the green bit and just be left with the variegated portion of the plant. But I don't want to, actually. I quite like it the way it is. I love it. So I probably will not be controlling that variegation and chopping it up. I mean, if I want a, like a proper variegated one, maybe I'll just go and get one. But so far, I like the way this one looks and I won't be doing anything about it. So this one also lives in a 14 centimeter pot in like a clay bowls. And you can see those are the roots there. It's just, it's happy. It's absolutely happy. Why would I want to fix it? Look at it. It's gorgeous. You know, it's almost getting to the top of its moss pole as well. So again, I have to start thinking about what I'm going to do. Am I going to chop the plant or am I going to extend the moss pole? Of course, these are the joys of having a moss pole. So yeah, and this one is doing really well. I don't know if you can see it, but you've got lots of area roots in that. And you can see those area roots over there that are just going straight into the moss pole. That is my philodendron burl marks, supposed to be variegated, but isn't, living in lecker clay bowls. You know I love a Hoya. There will be quite a few Hoyas showing up in this video. So this is my Hoya day key. I love this Hoya because it's got these gorgeous bumpy leaves. They just look so prehistoric. They just look absolutely amazing. Now, since I've had this plant, I don't think it's actually given me a new leaf at all. It's been one of those Hoyas that just sit there and do nothing for the longest time. It is living in Lekka. The root system's there. I mean, it seems happy enough in itself, you know. But some Hoyas just sit there and sit there and sit there and do absolutely nothing for the longest time. And it can be quite frustrating. But something is happening with this Hoya. Look at that. I've got that just popped up a few weeks ago. And I've got that pop up as well. So something is happening. And there's a little, I don't know if you can see that. They're really quite tiny right there at the bottom. It looks like there's two little new leaves that are going to be coming up. Whew! Finally, the Hoya is doing something. And this is going to be actually quite magical. Because can you imagine these leaves, you know, the shape, the bumpiness of them, lots of them, lots and lots of them. It's absolutely going to be fantastic. It's going to be really magical. So I'm happy with this one. It's made me really happy. It wasn't making me happy before. It almost did not make this list. And then when I saw those two little vines coming up, I was like, yes, 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 you are coming with me. So I wanted to show you guys that, you know, sometimes a Hoya does take a very long time to do stuff. As long as the leaves are looking healthy, just leave it alone and it will start to do what nature does and it will grow. And that is my Hoya Daykay. I don't quite know how it's pronounced. I probably should state that with my Hoyas, as you know, Hoya names get changed all the time and lots of people know different things by different names. I'm just calling stuff what I know it as. And if you know it as something else, that is okay. Feel free to let me know in the comments if you like. But I'm just, yeah, I can't keep up with Hoya names. These are my two Syngonium Stearmarki plants. Oh, I love this plant. So I had my Hoya Stearmarki, which was living up on a moss pole. And that was doing just fine. And then I did something to it. I spilled a chemical on it. And I absolutely damaged the leaves. I was very, very sad and unhappy. So I took it off the moss pole and I basically propagated it. And that is now my new plant. Look at those serrated leaves. They just look fantastic. That's a new leaf as well. And as you can see, there's a new leaf coming on there as well. So that's my plant living in the Lekka clay bowls. And that's the root system there. This plant is really, really happy. I'm very well pleased with it. So that's plant number one. So I did a few propagations because I literally had to decimate the whole plant. Look at that. Look at that. That leaf is just gorgeous. Absolutely gorgeous. So there's actually two plants in this pot. This plant over here and this plant over there. And that one is starting to, you know, get that little stalk going up and wanting to climb. So I'm not too sure what I want to do with this plant, actually. I might have to make a moss pole for her because she does like to climb. So, Yeah. Would you like to see a video where I put my Syngonium stemmae up on a moss pole? If you would, just let me know in the comments below and I'll make sure to make one. Otherwise, you know, I love to do things off camera as well. I do a lot of things off camera. So if you ask me to make one, then I can make one. But that is my Syngonium stemmae, looking absolutely fantastic, completely understanding the assignment and just being fabulous. Right, let's bring in something a little bit different. This is a peperomia. This is my peperomia shumi red. I love the color of this plant. Red is just stunning. Look at the color. You know, you've got the red and then you've got the undertones of gray in that as well. And you've got those, you know, little flowers that are coming up. This plant is really, really happy. This peperomia shumi red is actually living not just in Lekka. This is a concoction, a mixture of pon, Lekka, and perlite. You know, I just threw a few things together because I thought, you know, peperomias, they have very, very fine leaves, and sometimes Lekka on its own can be a little bit problematic. They need a bit more moisture than what Lekka alone provides. So I found that, you know, mixing that Lekka with pon and a little bit of perlite worked really, really well for my peperomia shumi red. And she is just happy as Larry. Let's go back to some anthuriums, shall we? Just, you know, I just really want to drive the point home that anthuriums can be happy in Lekka. Look at this one. I'm not even sure what this one is. It is an anthurium forgetii crossed with a crystallinum. That is what this plant is. Look at that. How gorgeous is that? I love how, I'm not sure if you can see it, but it's got this bumpiness to it, this leaf. I'll turn it around. Maybe you can see it from the back. It's got this bumpiness to it and it just looks absolutely fantastic. Look at that. It is just absolute perfection. And this one there is a new leaf. You can see that's just hardened, just recently hardened off. It just looks absolutely divine. More leaves there, and you can see, you know, doing the thing that anthurium do. And that's that, living in my Lekka clay balls. Look at that gorgeous root system that this plant has. I'm pretty sure this plant probably needs a repot. I need to go up a pot size, maybe put it in a 14 centimeter pot. And then I might probably need to get those, you know, there's some extenders that you can put to keep those roots that are right at the top, keep those contained and keep those moistened. I might need to do that as well. But for now, I am loving how my anthurium forgetii crossed with a crystallinum is loving life in Lekka clay balls. Oh, this is my Hoya Matilde. Look at this gorgeous, gorgeous mama. Now, look at that. How fantastic is that plant? Oh my goodness. I am just, look at that. There's just little flowers waiting to bloom everywhere. Look at that. This plant is just, I don't know. I absolutely don't know. She's glorious. She's absolutely fantastic. I've had this Hoya for a really long time. When I got her, she was so, so small. But look at how well she's growing now. Living in a 14 centimeter pot in Lekka clay balls. That's her reservoir there. This is another of my Hoyas that actually lives in my Hoya grow tent. And I'm telling you, before I had my Hoyas living in my grow tent, they were just, you know, they were okay. They weren't growing as prolifically as they are now, and they certainly were not flowering. But look at this plant. You know, in a few weeks, they're going to be flowers everywhere. I'm pretty sure these ones are going to open up in the next few days. And then I'm just going to have that divine, divine scent of Hoyas. I'm not quite sure what this one smells like. I've forgotten. I think it's flowered for me once before. But, oh, that is going to be amazing. This is my Hoya Matilde. But I'm going to show you what my Hoya Matilde splash looks like. Because you know I love a splashy Hoya. This is my Hoya Matilda Splash. You can see how those leaves are just looking a little bit more gray. They've got that splash going through them and they just look absolutely fantastic. This plant as well, you can see, is starting to get those little indications that it's about to flower. So I've got one there, I've got another one there, I've got another one over there. There's quite a lot of them everywhere, to be honest. There's another one over there about to flower. Oh, another one over there. It's just all over the place. This is my Hoya Matilda Splash. I'll grab my Hoya Matilda. This is my Hoya Matilda. So this is the Matilda Splash. This is the Matilda. Look at that. These are my Hoya Matildas. Both going to flower. Oh my goodness. Both living in 14 centimeter pots. Just looking the business. I love, love, love Hoyas. I love Hoyas. Hoyas are amazing. This is my Philodendron Birkin. Oh, I love a Philodendron Birkin. Look at those striations. Look at them. They look absolutely fantastic. So these are the new leaves coming. These are the whiter leaves. And you can see from this one, that is turning green. You can see that turning green. And you can see those lines coming through. It just looks so, so good. And I got this philodendron a few months ago, actually. And I purchased this philodendron to actually make a video. Specifically, I was looking for a large philodendron because I wanted to demonstrate how you can actually convert a big plant that's living in soil to start growing in lecker clay balls. And I think when I got this plant, these like one, two, probably four of these leaves weren't there. So it was still relatively quite large. And if you haven't seen that video, just click on the link above and that'll take you through it. But it's been a number of months now. This plant is well and truly used to living in the lecker clay balls. And I'll put this reservoir down so I can show you. Look at that. Look at that root system over there. This plant is really, really happy. Look at those new leaves. It is just those leaves are firm and it's really happy. So yeah, it is possible to actually get a big plant from living in soil and putting it to live in lecker clay balls and, you know, live the passive hydro life. But I do get a lot of people ask me the question, why would you want to get a perfectly good plant that's really relatively happy, yank it out of the soil and put it in lecker clay balls? Well, largely because I don't grow any of my plants in soil. I don't like to use soil. And there are various reasons for this. I find that plants grow so much better when they're growing in lecker clay balls. I don't have to put so much attention to my plants. I don't have to spend my whole weekend watering plants or forget to fertilize my plants because my plants have constant access to water and nutrition in that reservoir. So all I need to do is mix up my nutrient solution, put it in the reservoir, and my plant is good to go. Of course, as long as I'm providing the other conditions as well. So make sure the light is up to par, make sure the temperature is good, then my plant is going to thrive. But there actually are some people who do have more healthcare concerns with having soil. So maybe people who've got compromised immune systems can't have all that soil around them, or some people have allergies. So they also prefer to grow their plants in a place which is a lot cleaner than having soil. So growing plants in lecker clay balls is an option. So that's why I like to yank plants out of the soil, as people put it, and provide, just show people a different way of doing things, but also to show that you can do it differently and your plants will actually thrive. So this is my Philodendron Birkin, thriving in lecker clay balls. Well, now that we're talking philodendrons, I figured I might as well bring out one of my little faves. This is my Philodendron Beauty. And how beautiful is this plant? Look at that half moon leaf. You know, one side is lime green, the other side is lovely. Look at that. Just the varied variegation that this plant has is absolutely stunning. This plant was actually gifted to me by the lovely people from Tinker Garden. They brought this plant for me and it was like this when I bought this plant. It was so small, it hardly had any roots on it. But look at her now. She's absolutely fantastic. Those are her area roots over there. She's bending over. She's not happy. Hang on, I'll show you what those roots are doing. That's her root system over there. This plant is clearly living in too small a pot, and she's crying out for a moss pole. So yeah, this is another moss pole that I'm gonna have to do. And you can see she's got a new leaf coming there as well. That's a new leaf there. That is my philodendron beauty, and she is going to be stunning. I'm gonna put her up on a moss pole and watch her thrive, following on from variegated plants. Oh, look at this one. Alocasia Friedrich variegated. Oh, the leaves of this plant are like a work of art. Just look at that. How amazing is that? This is just nature at its finest, at its absolute finest. This is my Alocasia Friedrich variegated, living in a Lecca clay balls. That's its pot there. And this plant is just happy. It is happy. I've had this plant probably about a year now, and it actually did go dormant over the winter season, and this is her coming back. So this time I will try a lot harder to keep it from going dormant, and I'm going to do that by, I will have to keep her in a grow tent, because it's the only way I'll be able to control that temperature in very, very cold Melbourne. I will keep, and of course, because she's living in the grow tent, the temperature will be controlled, humidity will be controlled, there'll be a lot of light as well. So hopefully those things will make sure that I have this view 365 days of the year. Alocasia Friedrich. So I can keep alocasias alive, I promise. I can. Yeah, especially when they look like that, I have to try a little bit harder. Look at these gorgeous leaves. This is my Syningia leucotricha, also called a Brazilian Edelweiss. This is a little bit different. It's a codex plant. You can see it's got this large potato-y thing there, and that's its codex. It's got a tuber. That's a little tuber codex thing. And it is living in Lecca clay balls. So yeah, this is not a plant that a lot of people would think would do well in Lecca clay balls, but it actually has. This plant is thriving and it's alive. I did a video where I showed how I actually moved this plant over from soil to Lecca. If you haven't seen it, you know what to do. But I'm loving that this plant is actually still alive. So one of the ways I keep this plant alive is keeping a very, very shallow reservoir. So it's not in a deep reservoir like the rest of my plants. This is literally just a tray for a plant pot. And I put the nutrient solution on that, and that is it. And, you know, I'll let that sit for a week or more, depending on what the weather's doing in Melbourne. And when that's dry is when I will put more nutrient solution in there. And so this is new over here, and it does have some new growth that's about to come through. I'll put that down and I'll show that to you. You can see that new growth there and there. That's coming through as well. So, you know, this plant is really happy. I wish you could feel this plant at home. It is so soft. It's just, it's so soft. It's amazing. It's absolutely amazing. So it is possible to grow a plant that is like a codex plant or a little bit like a succulent in Lecca clay balls. And all you're doing is actually managing the reservoir, so it's not getting exposed to too much water, because that's all going to go in there and the plant's going to die. So as long as you're managing the reservoir, it's possible to grow a codex plant like this Syningia leucotricha in Lecca clay balls. It's Christmas time. My kids are wanting Christmas presents. And I was really hoping this money tree would grow a seven leaf thing, because apparently if it's got seven of these little leaflets, then you're going to get good luck. No such luck for me, but I'm still happy with this gorgeous baby. Look at how amazing my money tree is looking. And, you know, for the longest time, so many people kept asking me the question, can I grow a money tree in Lekha? Can I grow a money tree in Lekha? I'm like, I don't know. I don't even really want a money tree. But I went and got a money tree just so I could expressly answer the question, can I grow a money tree in Lekha? Yes. Yes, you can grow a money tree in Lekha. This is my money tree growing in Lekha clay balls. That is what that looks like. Absolutely thriving, loving life in Lekha clay balls. New growth everywhere. This plant is loving life. I do need to keep up with the braiding though. I keep forgetting to keep up with the braiding. Talking about money, here's a plant I spent a fair bit on. This is my Philodendron Spiritus Sancti. Oh! This is a plant you could have only dreamt about owning a few years ago because it wasn't yet in tissue culture and we were not about to start plant poaching. So this is a tissue culture plant. I actually purchased this plant from Pete of Pete versus Plant. And it was like this when I got it. It was really, really tiny. It was a very spur of the moment decision, but I do not regret purchasing that because look at those bunny-like ears, just absolutely thriving. And look at this new growth. That leaf is going to be a stunner. This plant is living in Lekha clay balls. That's my Lekha there. And you can see that root. Look at that root. Just, oh. I am loving my Philodendron Spiritus Sancti. It's going really, really well. Pete, if you're watching this, thank you so much, mate. There's your plant. It is absolutely thriving. And I'm now thinking I might have to give this plant some support because I can see the beginnings of what look like area roots somewhere down there. So I might need to provide some support for it. But in the meantime, oh, I just love looking at it. Philodendron Spiritus Sancti. Let's go back to the Hoyas. Let's go back to a Hoya. This is my Hoya Villosa. I think it's also called a globule something. I don't know. But this is a Villosa. I'm calling it a Villosa because it says it's a Villosa here. Ooh, look at that. I love those long leaves. And these leaves actually are a bit hairy. I'm not sure if that's something that you can pick up on at home. They're quite waxy, very thick and a little bit hairy. They feel so good to touch. Again, when I got this plant, it was quite small, but it's really coming along quite nicely. And I now have two branches. There's one here and there's another one over there. And oh, those leaves are just looking the business. I am loving, absolutely loving my Hoya Villosa. Every time I open my grow tent, I gravitate to this plant and I look at it and it provides me such joy. You can see the new leaves coming there and there. You know, it's going to be absolutely magical. I definitely need to think about putting this plant probably in a bigger pot and giving it a trellis because it's very soon going to become unmanageable. And if I'm not managing it on a daily basis, those stems are actually quite thick and I might end up damaging the plant. So I need to start doing something about that now. That is my Hoya Villosa. This is my Hoya Carnosa Compacta, or as was called, the Hoya Indian Rope. Man, if there's ever a Hoya that just commands interest, it's this one. This Hoya just says, stop and look at me because I'm fabulous. Huh? Look at how fabulous this plant is. Those little curly leaves are just, I mean, it's so, yeah, gorgeous. This is my big mama. You can see those roots coming from that pot down there, living in a 14 centimeter pot. Of course, living in Lekha clay balls, and I would really love this plant to just trail. I'm thinking in 5 years' time, this plant is going to be a beast. And she's just going to have those trails down everywhere. She'll have pride of place in my home somewhere. She'll probably have her own individual grow light because she's fabulous and she deserves it. Oh, I cannot wait. I also cannot wait for her to flower because her flowers look like that. And they're going to be lovely and gorgeous and pink. And it's going to be absolutely amazing. Hang on, do I see something that looks like a flower? No, nothing. But yeah, that is my Hoya Carnosa compacta. This is another Hoya that I've had for a long time. And for a long time, did nothing. Absolutely nothing. It did my head in. But as you can see, lots of new growth there. I'm getting lots of branches. So there's going to be, there's like one, there's this one here, two, three, four. There's four branches for now. And I'm pretty sure it's going to have more very soon. That is my Hoya Carnosa compacta, or my rope. No list would be complete without my Hoya Susie Q. I love my Susie Q. I love this plant. I can't even begin to tell you how much I love this plant. Look at that pink new leaf over there. Look at that. Look at this one. Absolutely fantastic, gorgeous and glorious. That's her living in her 14 centimeter pot and just thriving. You know, I've had this plant for over a year, I think. Most definitely over a year. And she was really small when I got her. But look at her now. That is my Hoya Susie Q doing what she does best, looking magnificent. Well, another anthurium. I don't show my anthuriums enough, you know. I think people actually don't believe that I do have anthuriums. This is my anthurium Forgetii crossed with the Hungry Uncle F2. That's what I've got written on here because I could never remember what they're called. Look at that. Look at that. It's got the bumpiness on there as well, which I think you can appreciate from here. And look at how shimmery that is. It is so shiny and shimmery and bumpy. Just looks amazing. Amazing. This plant is also living in Lekka clay balls. Tiny, tiny pot for now. I just recently acquired this one, so it's in a tiny pot. Anthuriums living in Lekka clay balls without soil. Yes, yes, yes. This is my Hoya Acuta Variegata. It's called something else, reticulata or something. Another plant that I got when it was very, very tiny. Look at this baby now. Look at the color of that new growth. I love how they come out looking a bit red and then those leaves change color. Look at that new growth on that plant. It's absolutely stunning. Absolutely stunning. Hoyas, honestly, are just the best. But look at that. Look at that. There we are. This plant is about to flower for me. There we go. Oh, and it's not just that. There's another one there. There's a few other flower points. And this plant actually flowered a few months ago. So it's really, really happy and just thrive. Look at that. I just can't get over how amazing Hoyas are, how varied they are, and how fabulous they look. That is the pot that she's living in. Lekka clay balls. That is her reservoir over there. She's just loving life. This is my Hoya Acuta Variegata. This is another one of my faves. This is my Hoya Crimson Queen. Oh my gosh. She's a queen just like me. I love queens. Look at how royal this plant is. Look at those leaves. Look at those leaves. They are just absolutely cream. They don't care. They don't need green. They're queens. Look at this one. But I love this one. Look at this one. It's got that little tip at the end. It's nipped in right there. It's such a gorgeous little leaf. But this plant is just so fantastic. These leaves have actually been on this plant for over a year. And I remember the first time I showed this plant, I had a lot of people commenting and telling me that those leaves were going to die because they were just white and that wasn't a good thing. And I was like, yeah, okay, maybe. But I can tell you that these leaves have been here for some time. They didn't believe me, but here we are. It's still the same leaves and they're still there. And now it's getting more. I'm not going to do anything about this. I could cut off the bit of the plant that's throwing out these white leaves, and then that'll just keep it looking boring. And like, that's, why do I want that? I'm going to keep those there until nature decides that they don't belong. For now, that's her. Look at that. Look at how amazing that looks. Look at that leaf over there. That is my Hoya Crimson Queen. This is my Raphidophora tetrasperma. Variegated Raphidophora tetrasperma. Look at those leaves. How gorgeous does that plant look? This plant was a gift from my lovely friend Rosie. She was so generous, gifted me this plant. And when I got this plant, actually, it was just a single leaf. It was this leaf. That was all, just the one leaf. And when I was transporting her from Rosie's house to my house, she got a little bit damaged. So I was left with half a leaf. It was a full leaf before. By the time I got home, it was like half a leaf. And I was mortified. I was so scared that this plant was going to die. I mollycoddled her. And this is what we've got now. She is just beautiful. Look at that variegation. Honestly, she's amazing. Oh, my goodness. Look at that root. Shucks. Look at that. That's that area root that's come from that point, gone back into the reservoir, and that's what that looks like now. Those are the roots down there. Now, I will tell you, this plant is actually not living in Lekka. This plant is living in pond. And that's because I do have a little bit of pond lying around the house because I love to buy lechuza pots. So sometimes I do like to try growing plants in pond, which is okay. And this is just a reservoir for that plant. But I need to start making some decisions about what I'm going to do with this plant now, because it's no longer a baby. It is throwing out some monster area roots and it's really crying out for a moss pole. Yeah, I know. Like, I need another moss pole in my life right now. You do know that moss poles are the bane of my existence, right? So I don't know. I mean, I have to give it a moss pole. What do you think? Let me know. What can I do? Maybe should I try a moss pole alternative? Maybe I should try a trellis. Do you guys have any ideas? Let me know in the comments below. But this here is my gorgeous variegated Raphidophora tetrasperma. Let's look at another syngonium. This is my Syngonium aurea. I am so in love with this plant. It is absolutely beautiful. Look at the different kinds of variegation that this moss pole has. That's a half moon one over there. This is a more varied variegation. Look at this plant. She is just looking absolutely beautiful on that moss pole. Look at that area root that's just taken hold of that moss pole and is going in that moss pole. There's more area roots over on this end. This plant is really, really doing well. But she's now over here. I need to start thinking about extending this moss pole because this plant is going to grow really big. And I do want it to grow really big because once it starts reaching maturity, the shape of those lobes of that syngonium starts to change and it starts to look really, really good. The thing that is concerning me, though, about this syngonium is the problem with all variegated plants. Invariably, you end up getting leaves that look like this. So you can see this is where this leaf had that sort of half moon variegation over there with that. So that invariably tends to happen. And you end up with, you know, messy looking leaves like that. Which, you know, it comes with a territory that can't be helped at all. This plant is still beautiful and it's going to look really, really amazing once I get that moss pole up and that leaf changes and they become mature. So that is my Syngonium aurea. This is another plant that I've had for quite some time, actually. And I have been chopping and propagating because I really wanted that moss coal to become bushy and not just have the one plant. So on here, I've got one, two, three. There's three plants living on this moss pole. And yeah, of course, it is living in lekka in a 14-centimeter pot. That is the root system coming through there. And that's that reservoir in there. So yeah, I'm really happy with how this plant is progressing. That is my Syngonium aurea. I'll show you my Monstera. This is my Monstera aurea. I've had this plant for a while now, and I've actually, it really got quite big. It's one of the plants that I haven't shown a lot of. I'm not too sure why, but I've chopped it up, and this is one of the cuttings. I think I got like six cuttings. Gave some away. I've got some dotted all over the house. But this slide is, it's just, I've just put it up in this 14-centimeter pot. It's new in this pot. And I love how those are still tiny Monstera leaves. And this plant is going to be a showstopper. She's going to be fabulous. I need to give her something to help support her. I'll put her up on a moss pole and she's going to grow and she's going to look absolutely fantastic. This here is another moss pole superstar. This is my Epipremnum manjula. Look at that leaf. Pretty much the size of my head. Look at that. Look at that. I'll step back so you can see what she looks like. That's her living in a 14-centimeter pot. That's lekka clay balls. I can't show you more because it's going to topple over. And I can't lift it up higher because that moss pole is quite high. So that's where the plant is at. It's still got some climbing to do, which is great. So I don't have to extend it anytime soon. But I love this manjula. This is a new leaf that's just come out. So it's still, you know, getting bigger and hardening. But look at that. It's just beautiful. I love this kind of manjula because, you know, you have those other really white kind of manjulas, and I find those ones tend to be a lot more difficult because those leaves just start to look a bit manky after a while. But this green one just looks absolutely fantastic, absolutely glorious. That is my Epipremnum manjula living on a moss pole, loving life in lekka clay balls. That's it. This is some of the plants that I've really been enjoying in 2023, and I can't wait to see what 2024 has in store for us. Check out this next video where I showcase some of my gorgeous variegated hoyas. I'll see you there.